at 88.1. This is listener-supported public radio. KKJZ Long Beach, Los Angeles. And KKJZ HD1 Long Beach. A service of California State University, Long Beach. Also worldwide at jazzandblues.org.
I hope you're having a marvelous Monday. I'm Steve Tyrell, and you're listening to K-Jazz 88.1. We're going to start this last hour off with a song I had the pleasure of producing for Rod Stewart on his album. We got together Chaka Khan to help us out, and Dave Koz, and we all got together in the studio and made one of my favorite recordings of anything I've ever produced, really, because it just has such a great spirit. And it started with Chaka. She came up with this intro, and then Dave came over and played, and the next thing you know, we were having...
Okay, let's call the order. Can we have roll call, please? Oh, let's do a pledge of allegiance. Please join Council Member Deaton in the pledge of allegiance.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Okay, roll call, please.
Mayor Viarapapa.
Here.
Mayor Pro Tem Deaton.
Here.
Councilmember Moore.
Here.
Councilmember Sestarsic.
Here.
Councilmember Masalavit is absent.
Yeah, can I have a motion to
so
excuse
move.
Councilmember Masalavit?
Second.
Please vote. Thank you. Four zero. Thank you. Approval of agenda and waiver of full reading of resolutions and ordinances. By motion of the City Council, this is the time to notify the public of any changes to the agenda and or rearrange the order of the agenda. Do we have any such changes or rearrangements of the agenda? Seeing none, we'll move to the next item, presentations and recognition. Fiscal year 2017-18 budget review. Do we have a staff report?
Yes, Mayor. Thank you. I'll turn this item over to our Finance Director and City Treasurer, Vicki Beatley.
Thank you, City Manager Ingram, Mayor, members of the Council. Tonight, I do have a mid-year budget presentation to go through. Oops, wrong one. For you. And if something comes up and you want to ask any questions, please do so. I'll address any, or I can address any questions at the end. But so for tonight, we got the usual presentation that I've gone through a number of times before. But starting off with our revenue, so the budget was adopted, and the revenue number is about $30.2 million. And to date, there's been no changes in the revenue dollars. Every year, we have sources of revenue that are fairly substantial, and these are the top five sources of revenue. We have the property taxes, we have sales taxes, we have utility users taxes, and we have property tax in lieu, which is part of the vehicle license fees that now come back to the city that are charged to the registered owners but come back to the city in the form of quote-unquote property tax, and we have transient occupancy tax. The list of the top five revenues are similar for each year, and just so you know, the top five revenue generators produce approximately 70% of the revenue budget. So for 2018, these five revenue sources alone will generate approximately $21 million for the city. Going a little bit deeper into the property tax, over the year in projecting the revenues, we actually have projected a 4.6% increase in the taxable value for property in the city, and that's compared to a 6% increase in the county. This increase for the city is actually better than it was last year and a little bit closer to the county dollar, but still not quite in line with the county. The most surprising thing is that 4.6 number actually is an increase in assessed value of $235 million. So the value of the property in the city, citywide, has gone up that $235 million. And that also does not include, it includes sales and it includes the Prop 8 recapture. And there are still a significant number of properties in the city of Seal Beach that fall under Proposition 13. So each time one of those is sold, that new assessed value comes on and the amount of revenue generated to the city is greater than it was as a Prop 13. And what Proposition 8 means is that if the value that we can adjust every year is limited to 2%. So each year, because it actually goes back to Proposition 13, the assessed value on a piece of property in the city can only increase 2%. Unless, for some reason, it didn't increase the full 2% in the prior year or it had a negative adjustment, we can recapture what was lost, hence the name recapture, and then increase the value by 2%. The city doesn't do it. The assessor actually does it. So for the year just ended in December, the median home price in Seal Beach is now $950,000, and that's actually down from this time last year by about $1,000. Not significant, and it's not as high. It's actually been over $1 million in a couple of years prior to last year, but it's nice to see that the values are consistently increasing. And Jesse, yes. Oh,
go ahead.
Sorry, on that slide, the assessed value increase, $235 million. Mm-hmm. Just to be clear, what percentage of that is ours? How much will we get?
You know, Council Member Deaton, Mayor Pro Tem Deaton, that is such a fantastic question, and I didn't even ask you to ask that question. But I'm transitioning to a chart right now. Because this actually shows that breakdown. So on average, properties in the city of Seal Beach get about 15 cents, almost 16 cents on the dollar that comes into the city of Seal Beach. And effectively what that number comes from is if you look on your property tax bill, there's an assessed value number, and the city receives 1% of the basic levy, which is can be seen on any property tax bill. But the nice thing about this is, you know, a lot of times when we have residents look at their property tax bill, they think, oh, my gosh, look at all the property tax I'm paying and, you know, what is the city doing with that money? But specifically showing this chart, it shows you that from a comparative perspective, the City of Seal Beach General Fund only gets the third largest component, and that is exactly from that 1% basic levy. Does that answer your question?
Yes and no. I guess what my question was, let's look at $235 million. How much of that would we get? What I understand 1%. So what is that?
Well, $235 million times 1% would be, what's the math? I can't do it in my head.
That's
$235,000? No.
Yeah, I mean, it's significantly less. So.
Yes. Oh, yes, it is significantly less. Yeah, I don't have my calculator out. I'm sorry. My brain's not in calculator.
So $235,000 is what you think?
Yeah, well,
anybody?
23,500 is 1%.
23,500.
Yes.
So from that 235 million, we get about.
No.
Wait, Patrick.
Sorry.
2 million.
1%.
So that's. Is that 10% or 1%?
Okay.
It's 1%.
Okay. Well, we will not get $235 million or $2,350,000 from that. So that's the assessed value is going up, but there's exemptions in the city. I'm sorry to be so confused about the whole thing. There's exempt properties.
Like you said, you didn't ask me to ask this question.
I know. There's exempt property that goes up in value but does not generate any sales tax. So, for example, the Naval Weapons Station is the largest property in the city of Seal Beach, and that is part of the assessed value. And so in order to answer the question about how much additional revenue we'd get from the $235 million increase in assessed value, I'd actually have to go back and look at the reports and see which properties would generate that revenue. But generally speaking, I would say that over the year, if we have the 2% increase, our property tax revenue in the general fund goes up about $200,000. So that's why I was saying that the $235.
Okay. Thank you. I'm sorry. I didn't mean to
ask
a question that was so convoluted.
Ms. Beakley,
in
addition to that question, I had a question about the median home price in Seal Beach.
Yes.
Does that also include or exclude Leisure World?
No, and that's why the number is so much smaller, Mayor Verapapa, because depending on the number of sales that happen in Leisure World versus outside of Leisure World, that actually brings that number down. I think in 2015, our median home price was over $1 million. And so the number of sales have roughly stayed the same, but the makeup of the sales have changed. And so likely because this has gone down, it means to me that there's more properties that have been turned over in Leisure World or some of the other less expensive areas of the city.
That's what I thought. Okay, thank you.
Okay, so moving right along. So from the perspective of the top 10 property taxpayers, I'd like to show this every year just so that you can see who the list is. And this is not in order of anything other than alphabetical because some of the information is actually confidential with regard to the amount of revenue that's generated. But you can see the top 10, and usually, typically, seven to eight of the businesses listed on here are usually in the top 10 each year. This year, there was the Apollo building over by Boeing that was there last year, and that has actually been replaced by Old Ranch Country Club. And I'll show you another chart now that shows what the makeup is of the properties in the city of Seal Beach. And this is actually very interesting as well. And so you can see right there, Mayor Pro Tem Deaton, right in the middle is those exempt parcels. So 334 parcels in the city are exempt from property tax. And those are, typically speaking, other government agencies or entities that are not subject to property tax. So that's a large number of the parcels. But you can see the number one parcel in the city is made up of residential homes. And then you've got a small portion of commercial. And I was actually... when I got this report last time, I reached out to our property tax folks that help us understand all these numbers and said, agricultural, I didn't realize there were six parcels. And so there's a couple of parcels that are declared agricultural that are not farmed, but the ones that we think about are actually the ones over on the Naval Weapons Station as you're driving along the 405 freeway. You can see the folks farming over there, but there are a couple of actually other smaller ones throughout the city. And so this is just a really good picture of what the makeup of the properties look like in the city of Seal Beach, and then just a graphical representation a little bit below here to show you what it looks like. So, you know, we are pretty significantly residential, and the primary source of property tax revenue in the city does come from the residential parcels. So with regard to property tax, then, just to wrap it up, we have a budget of just over $8 million. And so far this year, we've received about $4.4 million. So the receipts are ahead by about $284,000 as compared to last year. And I'm expecting that we'll do better than budget. But I want to give you a caveat here. So one of the things that occurred, as many of us know, is the current administration had adopted some new tax structures before the end of the calendar year. And because of, I'll talk about it more later, but because of the limitations on what's called SALT, which is the state and local tax ability to write off, the level has been capped. A number of individuals in the county of Orange decided to go ahead and pay their April payment before December, so that they could take advantage of the entire write-off for the year before the new law went into effect. And so because of that, the city actually received about $175,000 additional revenue that we would normally receive in April. We received it in December. So that what that means is the money that's going to come in April is going to be less. I'm not anticipating that we'll get the same amount of money and get that much more revenue for the year. But even if I net out the $175,000, you know, I'm still expecting that we'll be slightly ahead of the budget. And part of the reason is when we put the budget together, we use the best known information that we have. Generally speaking, we'll use that 2% as an inflator, and then when the reports come in from HDL, we make some adjustments, and then when the final report comes in, we see. So the previous slide showed that our projected revenue is going to increase about 4.6% according to HDL, and I brought ours in at about 2.7 or maybe 3%. So we're going to be ahead of the property tax budget, which is going to be a good thing for the city. Utility users tax. This is another largest source of revenue in the city. So far, we are about $1.8 million in collection, which is slightly higher than the same period last year, but ultimately lower than the year-end projection. And the reason I'm saying that is we'll come in less than the year-end projection is because as we were putting the budget together for this current fiscal year, the projection that I used for the estimate for the end of the year did not materialize. And I'm surprised that it didn't materialize given kind of what's been going on and the fact that we've had warmer weather, so more air conditioning and those kinds of things. But what I've done is reached out. The city has a subject matter expert that we've hired, Muni Services, that helps us understand our utility users tax, and reached out to them and asked them to provide some insight into why this number continues to decline. It's kind of surprising. One of the things that happened last year after we put the budget together was that the Public Utilities Commission altered the way that the Edisons of the world and the Southern California Gases of the world can calculate what they owe to the cities. And we were expecting to see maybe a decline of 25,000 to 30,000, but that may be the reason. It may have been actually a larger number, and so that may be part of the reason why our utility users tax did not finish as expected in the last fiscal year. And because of that, I'm saying, unless I see something different, we'll see the same level that we saw last year, which is going to be less than what's in the budget.
Can I ask a question? Vicki?
Yes.
The question I would have there is, so on my bill, when I pay state and local tax, are you getting what I'm paying, or are they readjusting it so that that money goes somewhere else?
No. We're getting what is on that, on your bill. So on your gas bill, on your electric bill, and on your telecommunications bill, the number that is on there is the number that is ultimately remitted to the city. But what I'm saying is that the number that's on your bill is calculated different than it was prior. And so because of that calculation, we're actually getting less than we had expected.
So they're taking some of what I used to pay and putting it somewhere else in that bill.
I think that you are probably paying less in utility users tax than you were last year.
Okay, that's my question.
Yes. So then moving on to sales tax, we have actually a pretty good composition of sales tax in the city. So you can see by components that our largest one there is general consumer goods, and that makes up, you know, a fairly substantial portion of the city's sales tax. The top 10 accounts in the city generate 33% of the entire sales tax revenue. And with regard to some of the information on this slide, last year the top 10 generated about 35% of the entire sales tax revenue. So we've had some nice diversification in there, not relying on those top 10 individual companies. But mostly one of the reasons why the fuel and service stations is still not a higher generator is because we're dependent upon the price of oil. And I know that we've had this conversation before, but we have a firm that's in the oil services industry that is not an oil producer. But as the price of oil finds, they don't have as much business. And because they don't have as much business, they don't charge as much sales tax, and because they don't charge as much sales tax, the city does not get as much as it used to from this sector. That being said, in the last quarter that just came in, it was really nice to see a fairly substantial increase in the check that we have. We have a revenue agreement with one of the producers in the city, and the amount of money that we sent to them had increased from the prior quarter. So I'm hoping that we'll be reflective of how they're going to go ahead and finish up the rest of the fiscal year. For just informational purposes, there's 769 registered businesses in the city of Seal Beach. The top, now we have the top 25% generate 57% revenue. So we have 10 at 33, top 25 at 57, and then the top 100 businesses in the city generate 89% of the sales tax revenue throughout the year. And again, Seal Beach receives about 1%, so I just have one more chart to show you, because a lot of people think that I come into the city of Seal Beach and I pay 7.75%, and what's the city doing with all that money, but it actually goes to a lot of different places. And you can see right here on this, the line that says City and County General Fund, that's the 1% that comes to the city of Seal Beach or any particular city. Some cities have their own sales tax that have been added on top of that, but generally speaking, cities and counties receive the 1%, which is called the Bradley Burns component of the sales tax. And then down below, again, just a chart of the how the breakdown of all the different, where the different revenues go. And then this, the one that's countywide transportation fund at 0.25%, that's actually the Measure M funds in the County of Orange. So that's a separate bucket altogether that you can see that they're spending projects doing different kinds of work on the freeways. But that's the Measure M component, the 0.25. So, moving right along, again, sales tax information is confidential and proprietary. And so, again, we're just showing you the list of the top 10 sales taxpayers in the city. And one thing that I will mention here is that the 76 gas station is actually new this year. Last year, there was two Chevrons on here, so 76 outpaced Chevron to make it into the top 10 list this year. But all of the other names, generally speaking, appear on this list every year. From a perspective of the budget, so the sales tax budget is just over $4.2 million. Right now, we're at about $1.3 million, so the receipts are lower than the same period last year. But as I mentioned previously, I'm thinking that with the improvement in the petroleum services industry, that we're going to actually be closer to in line with the budget, but I am projecting that sales tax will come in less than budget. Right now, the revenue is about $85,000 lower than it was last year, and we had a sales tax meeting with our subject matter expert, again, HDL, and they indicate that they're expecting that our revenues are going to be coming in less. We have another meeting scheduled with them next month, and I'll be very interested to see what kind of projections that they see. We have done a pretty good job bringing some new businesses into town. We just had an opening in the shops at Rossmore, and things like the, I believe it was a Talbot's that just opened over there. So that the revenue from that type of a store wouldn't be included in the projection that we had just had last quarter because it's a new store. So every time they come in, they being HDL, every time they come in, they adjust what the projections are, and we have a discussion, and we let them know what we're expecting to open and or close in the city, because it we'll talk about the impact both ways. So I'm cautiously optimistic that we'll be closer to the budget than HDL is showing us to be right now. So the property tax in lieu, that's that component that comes out of the vehicle license fees and comes back to the city that's apportioned through the state of California. Typically, we budget around $2.5 million. You can see I've budgeted $2,560,000, and the vehicle license fee received zero is actually okay because that's what we expect for this time of the year. This payment, the first one comes in January, and the second one comes in July. And so the January payment actually came in at about $19,000 higher than the number that was expected. So I'm anticipating these payments are fairly equal. I'm anticipating then that we'll, this particular revenue category will finish ahead of budget last year by about $40,000. Excuse me, ahead of budget at the end of the year by about $40,000. And then we also have the transient occupancy tax that comes in. So this is the hotel bed tax. and we have increased the budget in this fiscal year to mirror what was actually received in the prior fiscal year. Right now, we're at just under about $500,000 collected. So the receipts are lower than they were the same time last year. But we have one large payer that actually made a late payment. And while we don't want late payments to come in, actually the perk of getting a late payment is we get a late payment penalty. So not only do they owe us the money, but they pay a pretty substantial late fee. It's around 15% of whatever the remittance is. And that payment actually just came in today, as a matter of fact. So we'll see a little bit more revenue. But I'm expecting that the TOT will be in line with the budget as expected. And this budget was actually $100,000 higher than the budget last year. So I suspect that we'll be right in line with that number. Business license, about $500,000. We've received about $340,000. Receipts are better than last year. And I'm anticipating that the end of the year will be slightly better than budget. The reason why this number changes is because we have a couple of business license payers that are based upon gross receipts. And so if their sales don't do as well, then the revenue that comes in on their business license comes in less than expected. And this year, the revenue right now is about $70,000 ahead of the same time last year. And it's primarily because the gross receipts from those remitters were better than their prior year. So another good sign that, that businesses is picking up. We also have sales tax, that same sales tax consultant that I told you about. When we meet with them, we get a listing of all the businesses in the city, and we talk about revenue that's come in from their perspective, and then we take that information and go back and look at our business license and make sure that if they're paying sales tax, they have a business license in the city, and if they don't, then we go ahead and send them a nice little letter that says, hey, we thank you for doing business in the city. Please come in and sign up for your business license. And then one thing that's different this year also in that program is that for the first time, based upon legislation, transportation network companies, otherwise known as TNCs, otherwise known as Uber and Lyft, are required to get a business license in the city in which they are domiciled. So what that means is if we have a resident in the city of Seal Beach who operates Uber or Lyft, they are now required to get a business license in the city. And so we'll be tracking any of those kinds of receipts that come in to make sure that those TNC operators are a business license in the city. And that was specifically based upon legislation that came through and was began to be enforced with January of this year. So we haven't seen it before. Before, they actually didn't even have to have a business license because they weren't actually being monitored by anyone. So at least now this is a way to know where all the operators are, even though they're different than the taxi networks, and especially in Orange County, because we have that Orange County Taxi Administration Group, or otherwise known as OCTAP. And OCTAP does not monitor, they don't license, they don't regulate any of the TNCs. And so it'll be good just to know who's doing business in the city.
Ms. Beatley, could you speak a little closer to the microphone?
Yes, when
you...
sorry.
Continue. Thank you.
Overall, then the current revenue budget, as I mentioned earlier, is about $30.2 million. The revenue received so far is about $2.4 million, and it's about 41% received. It's not something that is a concern. This is typically where we are because the city actually has receipts that come in for 2 months after June that we accrue back into the year. I will tell you, though, the increase is approximately 7.6% better than it was this time last year. But the reason for that is that we internally made an accounting change, and we have operating transfers that come from other accounts into the general fund, and we've taken all those operating transfers in one entry this year instead of taking them quarterly. So that's part of it. And then the other part is $175,000 that came in from the advance pay of property tax that I mentioned. But I still suspect we'll be about $125,000 better overall in the budget than I anticipated when the budget was put together. From an expenditure perspective, We had a budget of about $39.8 million in the general fund, and we've had expense modifications that have come through, so our current adjusted expense budget is about $40.3 million. The $537,000 are from the purchase order rollover from the prior fiscal year. When the council adopts the budget, part of the resolution allows city staff to go ahead and roll over any purchase order encumbrances from the prior fiscal year. So there haven't been any budget modifications to the general fund through December. So this is all from that purchase order rollover.
Is there a breakdown of those?
Yes. We have a nice long list of everything that makes up. The expenses that we've incurred year-to-date are about $16.8 million, and so that's about 42% of the expenses. It's about $341,000 higher than this time last year, but I still think we're well below where we're going to finish, well below we are budgeted for the year. And if you take a look and just cut the year in half, because the city doesn't budget month by month, so we just have a metric of 6 months, which would be 50%. So I would expect to see 50% of the city's expenditures to have occurred by the end of December, and we're only at about 42%. So that's why I'm saying that I expect that we'll be under in the expenditure budget. So revenue slightly higher than expectations, expenses slightly lower than expectations is where I'm seeing us end for the year. I'll talk a little bit more about what I sort of see on the horizon in a few minutes, but I want to go through real quickly, go through some of the pension. We talk about this every year, and what I've added some additional information this year because we've started getting some of the PEPRA employees, a larger number of the PEPRA employees. So the PEPRA, for you, just a reminder, is the Public Employees Pension Reform Act that was adopted in 2013. So beginning with employees hired into city government after 2013, they have a separate retirement plan. And so what you can see here is the classic members, or the top one, the 2% at 55 pool for the miscellaneous, and these are all employees other than public safety. So for the employer contribution, the city pays about 9.6% and the employee pays 7%. In contrast, you can see now with the PEPRA employees that they are part of a 2 at 60 pool rather than 2 at 55, and the city pays about 6.9%, and the employee contribution is 6.5%. The employee contribution in both of these plans is capped at those numbers. So until there are some other changes that come through, because the idea of PEPRA was that the employees would pay half the normal cost or share half in the cost, but you can see that the city is paying slightly more, and part of that is because the city is required to pay any unfunded liability. So the city's number is always going to be slightly higher than the employee contribution on the PEPRA side. Just showing you the funding. So in 2015, the reports ended 2015 are the reports that we use for this current fiscal year, and we were funded at about 80%, which is actually, from my perspective, a very comfortable number. However, last year we were at 84.3%. So you can see the rate of return for PERS had an impact on the overall funding rate in the last year. And the funded ratio for PEPRA is 95.8%, and I don't have a comparative number because last year was we've had it had PEPRA employees for a couple of years, but the number was about 93-92% last year, so we're a little bit more funded. But you have to remember that this funding percentage is very small compared to in the pool compared to the other employees who are on the classic side. On the public safety side, so you can see the top is the classic pool, 3 at 50. The employer contribution is 21.4%. The employee contribution is 12%. With the PEPRA safety, and we have one employee that's in the PEPRA safety pool, so that pool is 2.7 at 57, and the employer contribution you can see is 12.7%, and the employee contribution is capped at 12.25%. And I skipped ahead, but I did want to remind you that the public safety employees are actually paying 3% of the employer's share. So funding, here we go. We've got the three plans highlighted. These are all public safety plans. So the top one was 77.1 in 2015. It was actually 81.1 in 2014. So pretty significant change in the funding ratio for the safety plan. For the Pepper plan, there's only one employee, and they just started last year, so there's no history there, although it's right now it's about fully funded. And then I added the fire safety component because we sometimes lose sight of this expense for the city. So the city currently is still paying for 41 retirees the funding of 73.8% versus 78.9% last year. And so these are the folks that retired when the city of Seal Beach switched from its own fire department over to the Orange County Fire Authority. The pension obligation bonds, again, we see this information on a regular basis. The really good news here is that the final payment for this pension obligation bond will be made in June of next year, and that'll free up about $1.3 million in the general fund. So it'll be really nice to see that final payment being made. The other post-employment benefits, those are benefits that are given to retirees for various forms of health care at various levels, depending on when they were hired. I will say that, you know, the city annually makes 100% of the required contribution. As we do, we make 100% of all of the CalPERS payments. And this year, we will have to do a new actuarial for the cost of that accrued liability. So we'll be seeing some numbers change in that area. So finally then, just wrapping up, we're still fiscally sound. We are financially responsible. And this year, for the first time since I've been here, though our reserves were funded at the minimum level. And in the past, they had been funded at the maximum level. And so we have some challenges that we have to face. We've been facing these challenges for a while. But we know already, moving into the new budget cycle, that we have some contract increases with Orange County Fire Authority. The council has an ad hoc committee that's looking at potential options for fire service in the city. And we also have increased CalPERS costs. Everybody in the state has increased CalPERS costs. And these are the two primary expense drivers in the city. So in the last year, we started at about $600,000 or $700,000 behind the eight ball when we put the budget together. And we're looking at about those same numbers this year. Every member of the Seal Beach team continues to control costs where we can, ensuring that the strategic plan goals are met and that the service delivery levels meet the expectations of the community. From a budgetary perspective, I believe that the current revenue budget can be achieved and that expenditures will be below budget. But this year, I'm going to add some words of caution, and that's where I talk a little bit more about the unknowns of the tax reform that's come through. We've already seen some changes. Yes, employees have seen increases in their paychecks because the payroll tax, the taxing structure went down. But we don't know what the limitations on the write-offs are, we don't know what impact the limitations on the write-offs for property taxes will have on property values in the city. I've talked to some realtors who think there might be no change, and I've talked to some realtors who think that the property values may decline between 6 and 10%. We just don't know. It's too early really to tell into the new year about that, but that's something that we have to be very mindful of because property tax is the largest source of revenue in the city. And right now, you know, we're looking at the end of the fiscal year, and we're anticipating that the property tax revenue will be higher than budget, but I could come back to you with a very different story in the next couple of months if we don't see those values continue to, maybe not even rise, but at least if they stay level, then we'll be fine. But if we start to see those values decline, then we have to have a different kind of a solution for how we might make up for the budget shortfall in the next fiscal year. And then the last comment, we know the retirement costs are increasing, and city manager was recently at a League of California Cities forum where they talked about them. CalPERS is reaching out to the entities across the state to come and talk to them. And those communications have actually started to make a difference to some, in some respects. CalPERS is listening, but, you know, there's challenges. There's challenges that we're going to have to face as we go from the current 7.5% down to a 7% discount rate. Those are going to have significant cost increases. And there's some studies out there that indicate that the CalPERS costs for miscellaneous might be as high as 30% in the next, I believe, 7 to 10 years, and the CalPERS costs for public safety might be as high as 70% in the next 10 years. So if you add those two numbers together, that's 100%, which means, you know, every dollar is going to be paid, used to pay for retirement. So CalPERS is really going to have to put some sharpen the pencil point and come up with some solutions. You know, part of it is they change the amortization, they change the mortality, and they're dropping the discount rate. And so all of those things combined are still sort of creating this perfect storm of the cost increases that are expecting to be seen over the next, I'm pretty sure, 5 to 7 years. I have faith in the system. I believe that CalPERS is well managed. I believe that they're trying to fix some challenges that have been occurring over the long run. And I believe, once again, that the city manager's voices will be heard and they'll do something to help us address the volatility and the costs. But I'm not on their board, and I don't, you know, follow the meetings. I'm not 100% sure where they're going. But the louder we can talk to them, the more likely they will listen and help us come up with some solutions. And with that, Rosie Note, I'm done, and I'll be happy to answer any other questions.
Okay, any council comments at this time? To the right? To the left? Any more?
Are we working on a 3 to 5 year plan out?
Yes, we have hired our financial advisor, Fieldman Rollap, and I've seen a rough draft of the plan, and we had a conversation. So we do have a model in place that we should be able to deploy during this next budget cycle.
Okay, thanks.
Okay, thank you.
Thank you.
All right, this time we'll have oral communications. At this time, members of the public may address the council regarding any items within the subject matter jurisdiction of the City Council. Pursuant to the Brown Act, the Council cannot discuss or take action on any items not on the agenda unless authorized by law. Matters not on the agenda may, at the Council's discretion, be referred to the City Manager and placed on a future agenda. Those members of the public wishing to speak are asked to come forward to the microphone and state their name for the record. All speakers will be limited to a period of 5 minutes. Any documents for review should be presented to the city clerk for distribution.
Hi, my name is Mary Trout. I live in Leisure Row. I'm here to talk about community choice energy. Community choice energy is a public-private partnership between the city and utility. It brings power purchasing under local control. The utility continues to deliver power over the power lines. Customers have the choice over what type of power to use.
Can you speak into the microphone a little bit, please?
Okay.
Thank you.
Sorry.
Nice and loud. Thank you.
Okay. How community choice energy works. The source will be community choice energy, buying and building electricity supply. The delivery will be the utility, delivering energy, maintaining lines, and billing customers. The customer will be you, benefiting from affordable rates, local control, and cleaner energy. The downsides of the current system. Monopoly on power delivery, artificially elevated pricing. Utilities have little incentive to operate efficiently. Dependence on single electric provider during peak periods leads to less resiliency and increased power outages. Reliance on monolithic utility creates vulnerability during natural disasters. The benefits of community choice energy. There's local control, freedom of choice of customers, including the choice to opt out, competition in the marketplace, driving prices down, local jobs and economic development, improved air quality, promoting public health, self-supporting, it's self-supporting, not government subsidized, provides potential cost savings for businesses. How do we pay for community choice energy? It's revenue-based, not government-subsidized. Self-supporting from existing revenue stream, the electricity bills. Current electricity rates used to pay providers are redirected to the community choice energy providers through the city. So what is next? Approval of feasibility study to ensure due diligence on financial costs and long-term benefits for customers, either individually or partnered with another city or cities, as well as collection of information from cities and counties that have already implemented community choice energy. There's also going to be a public event on community choice energy organized by OC Clean Power at UC Irvine, which will consolidate data in informational panels and workshops featuring community choice energy experts from around the state. This event is April the 11th, 2018. It's titled Understanding Community Choice Energy and Its Opportunities. It's a half-day guide for Orange County cities and clean energy shareholders. It's from 10 a.m. to 11 p.m. at UCI Irvine Student Center. And I've supplied flyers for this event with the city clerk. Thank you very much.
Next.
Good evening, Mayor and City Council. Joyce Ross Parquet, Old Town Seal Beach. Owner of multiple units, like others in town. When will you're a state employee and you know about the legal system, so how long do you think you can push back what the state of California wants done for people that own units? How long do you think you can push it back? They have new codes this year already, and you haven't even done anything for the codes of a year ago. How can you all sit up there and push it back? It's got to be answered some way or another because they've come up with new codes. So last time I was here, I was going back over things that didn't happen in this city to make it better. So I didn't get to the pensions and I didn't get to Main Street. So how many times did I come down here and complain about the pay was in front of Nick's? And you gave her a pay raise when I asked you not to? And then that lady fell. So my next question is not on anything up there. How much is our insurance cost gone up? For slip and fall. Slip and fall. How much has our insurance gone up for other items like we hear about in Sacramento and up in Washington? Seems like every city has one. The other cost, the hidden cost that nobody wants to talk about. Why isn't that insurance cost a slip and fall here? The new California Leisure World has no houses. The houses are down here and in Surfside that are of value, making everybody else's more valuable too. Little World has co-ops. Remember when they didn't pay the taxes and they came down here and asked us to pay the taxes? You weren't here, Mayor. So, well, we didn't pay their taxes. They had to pay them because they were late, but they were not as much as what happened to the Eves. They've been sold a couple different times. How much is that taxes? The broker sitting over there should know. How much are the taxes for the Eves? They've been sold a couple different times. How much are the beachfront properties going for? See, the pier and the beach and all of us that live in units and the people that will pay to live on the beachfront make this city. And Main Street, we have vacancies on Main Street. Businesses are not shoving in here. We have vacancies. Have you noticed? And then, how did an insurance company get on Main Street? Tell me about the retail. Somebody show me the retail from an insurance company. So I'm over. I went on the internet. I couldn't see anything up there, so I went to the library. And I go through a lot of all of your checks, and I get to the bottom to the old redevelopment agency, and there are payments out there that I thought don't belong in there. Are you trying to hide something?
You have 1 minute.
I have 1 minute. So, some of the checks were paid twice. And why are we paying a conference fee for Mrs. Beatley, the treasurer? And you know what somebody else asked me to find out? Do either one of you teach at Cal State Long Beach and we pay the parking fees for you to teach? And who came up with this theory that there was going to be a three-story condo built at Rivers Inn? There's not going to be any three-story condo. There's not going to be an increase in the yard space. It's just going to be a new restaurant. And he promised to close it at 9 o'clock, right now. And how much money did you get when the DWP was sold? How much money? And how much more is coming? Thank you.
Thank you. Anyone else?
Good evening, Mayor and City Council members. My name is Jim Brady, and I want to address the rising crime rate in Seal Beach. I think that most informed people would agree that the two major reasons for the increase is, one, we need more police officers on the street, and second, the passage of Propositions 47, 57, and AB 109. I will address the need for more police officers at another time since I've got limited time. I want to talk and address the Prop 47, 57, and AB 109. By the way, the genesis of the two initiatives and the assembly bill was because the California Supreme Court told Jerry Brown that they were going to hold him in contempt if he didn't reduce the number of prisoners in prisons. So instead of building more prisons, they decided to release them and put them back into society. Just as a quick refresher, AB 109 was passed by the state legislature and signed by Jerry Brown in 2011. It eliminated return to prison for parole violators. So when somebody violated the parole, they don't go back to prison like they used to do. And basically, they don't even go in front of a judge anymore. They go into jail for a couple of days, and then they're released back on the street. They have to commit a new crime that qualifies them to go to prison before they go back. Proposition 47 was passed by voters in 2014. It reduced some felonies to misdemeanors, things like drugs, shoplifting, bad checks, forgery, sex sex trafficking of a child, rape of unconscious persons, assault with a deadly weapon, domestic violence, serial thefts, assault on a police officer, and it also reduced the ability for the police to collect DNA samples. When this initiative was going around in the proposition, the proponents of it called it the Safe Neighborhoods and School Act. It doesn't even come close to that. Proposition 57 was passed by voters in 2016. It released nonviolent offenders, people like rape by drugs, assault with a deadly weapon, drive-by shootings, exploding a bomb to injure people. Those are all nonviolent under the proposition. And you may have read recently or heard that on last Friday that a Sacramento judge ruled that under Prop 57 that the language is not going to keep sex offenders in prison, and there's going to be probably in a very short future about 10,000 that are going to be released in California. I don't know how many of them will be down here, but they're going to be released. So this is happening every day that we have. So obviously the passage of the legislation and propositions had negative unintended consequences. And as a result, the police were handicapped when dealing with suspects. Parole violators spent a few days in jail and then released. Concerning the felonies that were reduced to misdemeanors, the police can only issue a ticket, and just like a traffic citation, and release the perpetrator right there at the scene to go right back into the community. The crime rate is rising in California and Seal Beach, and we need to put criminals back into jail. Now, over the years, there's been numerous pieces of legislation that have been introduced in Sacramento.
You have 1 minute.
Okay. In Sacramento, and they've died. They haven't been able to fix these, so we need to do something to fix the propositions and the assembly bill. And what's happened is that there has been a group of people within the state of California that have put together an initiative. We're trying to get a proposition to be put onto the ballot in November 2018. And the initiative is called Reducing Crime and Keeping California Safe Act of 2018. And by the way, not only is crime rate going up, we're not even counting the same crime rate that we used to count, because a lot of the crimes that have been reduced to misdemeanors are no longer counted as Part 1 crimes, and crime rate is still going up. I just wanted to let the people of Seal Beach be aware of this particular initiative. I would like the city of Seal Beach to get with other cities, with the police departments, and with the DA's offices, and support this initiative. If anybody wants to sign one at the conclusion of the council meeting, I've got petitions with me. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Anyone else?
Good evening, Robert Goldberg, Seal Beach. I have some questions for staff on the budget presentation. If I could see slide 13. Ms. Bailey, could you put slide 13 up for me? What I'm trying to, my questions are going to be focused on one issue, and that is that with the budget, we had an expected amount of revenue and an expected amount of expenditures. And I'm trying to nail down, I'm trying to understand how much they are up or down. And I'm not quite clear, but perhaps looking at the slide, we might be able to get a little clarity. The slide 13 that I wanted to look at had to do with general fund revenue. And the slide, the statement was made, and the slide states that revenues increased or expected to increase about $880,000 compared to the prior year. Okay, that's not the question I'm interested in. That's not what we should be interested in. Not what it did compared to the prior year. It's what is it up or down versus the budget for this year? That's what I'm trying to get at. Because for this year, for example, with the general fund revenue, we expected it to go up 500,000. So if it's going up 800 and I'm rounding 880,000, I mean, that is good. But that means that the net revenue is up maybe 280,000 compared to what we thought. Okay. That's the way I would interpret this, what's been presented, that we're probably going to have 280,000 more than what we thought in the budget. Okay. The next slide is the expense, general fund expense review, slide 16, which is on the next page of the handout. So this is the other side. And here we have a statement that the overall expenses have gone up 341,000 compared to last year. Well, how much did we think they were going to go up? Looking at the budget, and I'm assuming this is applying to non-CIP, just the operating expenses of the general fund. So just looking at forget the projects, just the operating expenses. We are expecting the costs to go up 6,000, and it looks like the costs are going up 341,000. So our expenses, I would interpret this that our operating expenses are going up about 335,000 more than we thought. It seems that our operating expenses are going up about 335. Our income, I think I said 280 on that. So it's about a wash. I mean, these are just projections. So the way I would interpret this is overall, the increased revenue is being pretty much balanced by increased expenses, and it's pretty much a wash. That's the way I would interpret that. Changing subjects, going to the parking management contracts, the four contracts that are on your agenda tonight, and I know we're going to have a long discussion on that. And I gave you a couple pages of questions, but stepping back, trying to see the forest through the trees, I hope after tonight's presentation that you all and the public get a comprehensive view of who's doing what. Because right now, in the program we have right now, we've got three contractors doing various things. We've got EBM services taking care of the beach lots, collecting the coinage there. We've got City of Long Beach collecting the coinage on Main Street. And then we've got a company called Data Ticket that actually processes the citations, et cetera. And those three contracts, I think, cost us about $250,000 in total, plus or minus. So we have those three ongoing contracts. I'd like to know what's going to happen to those. Are those costs going to go up or down? And now we're adding, four other providers. So we're going to have at least seven vendors/contractors involved. And that brings up the whole issue about coordinating all that, compatibility, et cetera. So I hope that you'll explore that further during the presentation. Thank you.
Thank you. Anyone else? Seeing no one else, we'll move on to the next item, the city attorney's report.
Thank you, Mayor. Members of the council, prior to the meeting this evening, the city council met in closed session regarding the one item of personnel matter on personnel negotiations on the posted agenda. Councilmember Masalabit was absent. Council took no reportable action.
Thank you. Next, city manager's report.
No items tonight, Mayor. Thank you.
Thank you. City Council comments. We'll start with Councilmember Sestic. If you're not ready, we can.
I got my paper. Good evening. I just wanted to report that I attended the grand opening of the Dunn Edwards Paint Store We have a new business that's up near the Ayers Hotel, and everyone was very excited, and it was a very fun event. They are happy to be in Seal Beach, and we're happy to have them. I attended the investiture of Joanna Schilling, the new president of Cypress College. That was also a nice event. Excuse me. And I attended the Cypress College Americana Awards this last weekend, and last week the California Water Fix Breakfast put on by Metropolitan Water District and the ACC, ACCOC. The update on that is that they have the wind tunnels project planned. It looks like because the Central Valley is not really stepping into it, that it might be a one tunnel, but they're trying to move ahead to try to help bring especially overflow kind of water on the wet years down here to Southern California. So anyway, thank you very much.
Thank you. Mayor Pro Tem Deaton.
Yes, just one thing. I just want to say congratulations again to Steve Masoner, who was our Citizen of the Year from Seal Beach and received his recognition at the Cypress Americana Awards, which is a fundraiser to support our students as they go through the Cypress College. So that's all I have.
Thank you. Councilmember Moore?
Yes, I also went to the Americana, and it was nice to see so many Seal Beach people there. I went to the chili contest about a week ago on Main Street, and I really enjoyed going to each restaurant and trying the different chilies. I've also been communicating with the police department and Brian Gray, clearing out the homeless encampments, and he's really done a great job, and I really appreciate the police effort in that area. Thanks.
Thank you. I also attended the Cypress College Americana Awards. We recognize Steve Masoner, great asset to the city. It was a nice event, and we're proud to have him in our neighborhood and helping out with the beach cleanup. And that was it. Our next item is the council items. I guess there's no council items at this time. We'll move on to the consent calendar. Items on the consent calendar are considered to be routine and are enacted by a single motion, with the exception of items removed by council members. There were no items removed. Do we have a motion?
I'd like to move approval of the consent calendar, please.
Second.
Second.
Please vote. That's 4-0. Thank you. We'll have another public hearing. I guess there's no public hearing for this next item. Unfinished and continued business. We have the professional services agreement for parking equipment, technology, and services. Do you have a staff report for that?
Yes, Mayor. Thank you. I'm going to turn this item over to Police Commander Steve Bowles, and I know he will most likely turn the item over from there to our parking project manager. Commander Bowles.
I'm not going to touch the microphone or the podium for everyone here. They always say you're not supposed to go to work or go to school when you're sick, but I've been waiting 2 years for this night, and I'm going to let it go by. I represent a part of a team, a parking project management team, that's worked very, very hard for this night and for us to be moving forward with our parking plan. I know many of you heard me speak about parking before. I'm not going to provide you with any more parking fatigue. Just know that all the vendors that we have chosen tonight are the best in the industry, and we have chosen each one of them to be a part of our team. Back in 2016, we came to you and the council approved us to move forward with two contracts, one with Parkeon, which is a vendor we chose tonight who does the multi-space meters. And we also chose a company called New Park. At that time, as the speaker said in public comment, that company said they could be the one-stop solution. We could get rid of all of our other vendor contracts. But what we realized at New Park, the company who said they could perform all the duties that all these other vendors that we're talking about tonight could do, they just couldn't perform. And one thing when we realized looking into parking was, it's like if you have a car or something that where something breaks, you want to be able to go, be able to find another part and put it into your system. If we went with one company and that company failed, we would have a We'd have hundreds of thousands of dollars lost. So what we've done is created a team of outstanding vendors to represent our parking team as we move forward. I'm going to turn this over to Julie Dixon. Julie's our parking project manager. She's run both of our town hall meetings that we've had. I know you've met her before. She's going to go into how we completed our pilot project, why we chose the companies that we have, and we look forward to answering any of your questions. Thank you.
Thank you, Steve. So, again, I'm Julie Dixon. It's actually hopefully just really kind of a review tonight because you've all been so actively involved, as well as many of the community members that are here tonight from the stakeholder meeting. So my hope tonight is that this really is truly just a review. And I think, as everyone knows, this is really the first phase of the parking plan that we have for the city of Seal Beach. So there's definitely more to come. But some of the things that you have in front of you, again, Steve mentioned that there are a few vendor contracts that are in front of us. One of those items is to introduce the new smart meters to Main Street. So the Main Street parking lots will actually experience the new smart meters where you can actually pay with your credit card at the parking meter. We're actually introducing new pay stations, and we're going to go into these in more detail as we go through the slides for the beach lots. Also, we're actually going to be able to enhance enforcement throughout the city by utilizing LPR technology, which is license plate recognition technology, and we'll talk quite a bit about that. And then also another customer convenience, which is mobile payment, so that it will hopefully make it for a more improved customer experience for our visitors coming into Seal Beach. So the first thing I'd like to touch on, and we basically ran a pilot, and it ran at the end of summer from between July and into September, where we actually had two different vendors that brought their product to Seal Beach, and we ran the products for over 60 days, and we actually reached out to the community stakeholders and yourselves and asked everybody to go out and really utilize this experience and provide us with their feedback. The meter that's on the bottom right corner is by IPS Group, and that's the selected meter that we'll be moving forward with. That meter is also very prevalently positioned all throughout Southern California. IPS is actually the industry leader. Importantly about the single space meters is that, as you all know, the previous equipment, you could only pay with coins. And in fact, a lot of our downtown merchants complain because people are always going in there and asking for quarters and things like that to try to make it so that they could extend their parking payments. And you can see that just in this brief trial period, we had over 60% utilization with people paying with their credit cards. And one of the other features that we heard from our parking enforcement staff was that it was very easy to enforce because the bright lights really make it clear with a flashing red light if the meter time is expired. Now, the parking vendor IPS also offers a sensor upgrade. It's an option that we've included in the contract, but it's not something that we're necessarily opting to proceed with at this time. There's a couple of values that come along with the meter, with the sensor, and that includes to be able to reset the time on the meter so that if a car pulls out, it zeroes out the meter. But it's not necessarily something that the team is actually pursuing at this time. And this is a great opportunity to really highlight the fact that this whole experience, this whole upgrade, this whole approach towards parking is really about compliance. It's really about trying to, you know, improve the overall experience. This is not meant to be a revenue generator. And so we really want to emphasize the fact that this investment is really about the customer experience and how easy it is to find parking, how easy it is to pay for parking. And that's one of the reasons why we actually selected the single space smart meter that's there in the bottom right corner. The next part of this process is the pay stations. Now, the pay stations, the one that's on the left side of the pictures, that's the machines that are currently in the beach parking lots today. And one of the factors that we had to pursue is because the pay station is actually going to be expiring in March for what's called PCI compliance. PCI compliance has to do with the credit card authorization procedures and what is required in order to be able to process credit cards. So we knew we had to make a technology change or make a substantial investment in the existing hardware, and that's what led again to the pilot where we experimented with three different parking pay station vendors and got the feedback. And the parking on meter, which is the vendor that's on the right side, is an example of the pay station that was actually selected. And we've actually been able to work with the vendor very strategically to make sure that pending tonight's approval, that if it's selected and approved, then we'll actually have that infrastructure installed by March, because this is a really important factor. We want to make sure the equipment equipment is in place in time for the spring break holidays, and again, have the ability to accept the credit card payments at those locations. Another nice feature about this, and this will lead into the license plate recognition technology, is that we're actually going to be transitioning the beach lots to what's called a pay-by-plate solution, so that factors, when people visit, they'll actually utilize their license plate as their permit number. And it actually simplifies the process, whether you're paying by phone, which we'll talk about in a moment, or at the machine. But what it also does is it eliminates the ability for people to pass back the receipts. What you may or may not realize, it's a very prevalent issue in what's called a pay and display setup, which is what you had before, is that maybe I just came down to the beach, you know, and I left by 10 a.m. I could hand my receipt to the next person and say, okay, free parking for you for the rest of the day. Or I could even sell my parking pass to somebody, and that's been known to happen when you have a pay and display setup. And so now it's basically associated with the license plate of the vehicle, so you can't pass back the receipts. So we mentioned license plate recognition technology, and this is also going to be really relevant because not only is it going to make our parking enforcement officers more effective and more efficient in the field, but it's also going to allow us to collect occupancy data. That's really important when we start to talk about needs and improvements for our city streets when it comes to making permit rules or time limit rules. The data that we can actually collect from the license plate recognition technology can really help us make smart decisions in the future. But what it also has is this auto-chalking feature. And the vendor that we've selected, which is called Genetech, they actually, their distributor that we'll be working with, we're contracted with PCS Mobile. The technology that they offer has a proprietary feature for chalking. So what we may all be accustomed to is the parking enforcement officer that goes and runs the chalk on the physical chalk on the tire. Well, one of the challenges, and we've heard this specifically on Main Street, is that some people may be known to go out and rub the chalk off the tire, or maybe just roll their tires back and forth, or maybe hopscotch to the next parking space. With the actual geolocation tools, with the auto chalking, you're actually going to be able to identify that vehicle and have photographic evidence that the vehicle didn't relocate. So, again, this isn't meant to be a punitive solution, but what we really want to do is educate our people that are parking in Main Street especially, and also around the downtown community, that the parking regulations are there for a reason. We're looking for vehicle turnover, transitions, so that our commercial businesses can actually have the people, we can have the tables turning over in the restaurants, and it's not necessarily the employees or business owners who are parking on Main Street for 8 hours. So this particular tool will actually be able to help us with that compliance factor. The other item that's really key is permits, is that we can actually utilize the LPR technology so that we're prepared to actually manage the permit parking utilizing the LPR. What a lot of you don't realize is that this last December, we actually implemented some of the new permitting processes, and we had a lot of feedback from the community that it was much more efficient this year. Our hope for next year is that it'll also be more efficient. But this year was also the key where we started to capture the license plate information very specifically so that hopefully over this year we'll be able to transition to this virtual permitting solution so that everything becomes plate-based. And it's going to be much easier to enforce so that your parking enforcement officers can actually drive the streets and monitor the license plates of the vehicle to indicate if it's a valid parking session or not a valid parking session. This will happen both for the permitted areas and also in the paid parking areas because those locations will be based on the license plate. Importantly as well is that Genetech actually integrates with the law enforcement databases so that it can identify stolen vehicles or BOLs. That's all thresholds that the police department can set. It can also identify what are called scofflaws, people that have delinquent or unpaid parking citations. You can actually use the LPR technology to monitor and capture those particular violators as well. Now, I touched on this already, but mobile payment is basically another factor. It's another convenience that we've offered so that patrons can actually pay utilizing their phones. One of the nice features about mobile payment is that once you set up your account with the mobile application, you can park and just start a session with, like, literally the touch of the application. And so this is also a nice convenience because if you're at the beach parking lot, Maybe I only intended to come for an hour, but, you know, the waves are so great that I just want to extend my time. Without having to go back to the pay station, I can stay in my beach chair and actually extend the time. The important thing I always like to highlight about mobile payment is that whatever the business rule is or whatever the time limit is, you can set that requirement so that if the Main Street parking spaces are for the parking lots are two-hour time limits, you can't extend beyond those two-hour time limits. But at the beach parking lots where you can park all day, you can basically extend to whatever that business rule is for that location. So this is not necessarily a get-out-of-jail-free card. I can't pay for 4 hours of parking in the Main Street lots, but what we always like to identify is whatever the business rule is for that parking location, the mobile payment provides that convenience. And this is something that, working with the vendor Passport that was selected for this particular solution, there's all sorts of really neat features that come along with this too. Marketing and branding and things that could be implemented, like merchant validation programs, all sorts of neat bells and whistles that we're not starting off with all of that, but basically triggers that we can pull on as the program evolves and different features and functions that can come along with this, like special event rates, special event parking, all sorts of cool things that come with this, but again, not necessarily on day one. So we've had a lot of folks mention the fact that there are so many vendors, but one of the things that the commander mentioned was the fact that, you know, having the, you know, all-in-one package. We work with a number of municipalities that have actually invested in the all-in-one solution. And while that may work well for some agencies, there have also been a number of agencies that have been stuck with companies that have maybe not performed as well, and they put all of their revenue and all of their parking operation in that one location, and it hasn't necessarily proved to be ideal. In this particular case, I really have to emphasize what the commander said is, you truly do have best-in-class services, and I think that that's something that's really relevant. And the other factor for all of the solicitations that we've done and in all of the contract agreements that your city attorney has reviewed is that our integration requirements with all of the technology providers. You heard me talk about LPR. You've heard me talk about your permit system. What's really neat about this is that the fact that the vendors basically all communicate to each other, and it's all in the cloud. It's all happening in the back end. Your parking enforcement officer handhelds that are provided by Data Ticket can basically validate the license plate, can validate the payment parking session from the mobile payment, from the pay stations. It all ties in together, the LPR, all of the pieces overlap, and that's basically been one of the reasons what we've been working on in the background is making sure everything communicates and everything's the checks and balances are all there and that all of the data belongs to the city. That's also a really important factor that we went through with the city attorney on all of the agreements that we have in front of us. Currently, we have ABM in the city of Long Beach, that are providing the support for the parking operation and the technology, and this is something that they'll be incorporated into the training programs that will go on over the next couple of months, and it's something that we really have to evaluate in terms of the long term. As we're putting the technology, we'll look at solicitations for potential future support agreements for all of this technology as well, but that all ties into the phase two part of it. The fact of the matter is, there's a lot of stuff up there on the board, and it took us a little bit of time to get to this point. We ran a number of solicitations. We ran the technology pilots, and we have to make sure that we do this incrementally, because if we do everything at one time, it really becomes overwhelming, not only for staff, but also for the community. The fact is we need to basically make sure that we take this from a very approachable, incremental implementation so that the community is also prepared for this. There's a whole public outreach campaign. There's a whole, you know, messaging part of this process with the kickoff, because we want to make sure that everybody understands how the technology works. We want them to understand when it's being implemented, and that all comes after tonight, depending on how everything moves forward, and there will be that whole public outreach component of it. As many of you are aware, because we've had a couple of stakeholder meetings, just some of the high-level items that have come out of the meetings in regards to some of the public concerns. We've definitely tried to incorporate as much as we could possibly into this initial technology solicitation and what we're presenting tonight, but we do have a plan to come back to the public in April and be able to talk about the next phase of their approach, again, subject to tonight's approval, being able to then talk about the implementation, the impacts, and then let's start to talk about the parking strategies to really dig in on some of the challenges that we've heard from the stakeholders. a lot of the issues that we've had as well come back to the municipal ordinances, and that's something that we've actually been working with city staff on as well, is that we're going to propose some improvements to the municipal ordinances to help us deal with and manage some of the parking challenges. So that's coming in the next phase, as well as some of the other issues in managing this as well. And in regards to the timeline, the implementation, I mentioned that the parking on pay stations will be installed in March. Overall, this whole parking technology solution for everything that you see in front of you, we're really looking at about a 60-day implementation process from the notice to proceed. So let's just assume that after tonight, if everything goes well, we have about a two-week contracting signature standpoint. So we're really probably looking at it about March 1. The hope is that everything that you see in front of you for all of the vendor agreements, we should be implemented within 60 days of that notice to proceed date. So, and I feel very comfortable with all the technology providers because we've been working so closely with them. This is just a sample of some of the information that we've shared with the stakeholders in regards to the different elements of the different phases. And I mentioned the next phase is really when we start to talk about policy. We needed to get all of the equipment ordered and get that part of the process going. And now we really want to dig in on different things like the Uber and Lyft, like Vicki was mentioning earlier, ways that we can address and improve their drop-offs and looking at, you know, safety issues of the locations for passenger loading and unloading, looking at some of the branding and the signage of how we communicate where people should park and how they can find available parking. And then that leads into, you know, some of the more longer-term aspects of looking at the issues of where to expand parking to, as well as looking at the residential parking permit programs as well. But those are all things that we'll tackle in the next phases. And with that, any questions?
Yes, I believe we have many questions. I'll start with anyone who wants
to. Could you start with me, because I am going to need to leave.
Go ahead.
Okay, thank you. First of all, Julie, it's been a real pleasure having you. I just want you to know you run a great meeting.
Oh,
and
thank you.
When I grow up, I want to be just like you. Okay?
Thank you. That's
you've very you've done a great job.
Thank you.
You've also done a great job of listening to everyone. So I have a few questions here, and I apologize. I need to get home tonight. I have something I need to take care of. But I have a few questions that I'm in mid-year budget, that's why. Sorry, paper shuffling. Signage, I see you have that in phase two. Is that correct? Did I get that right?
Yes.
On the signage? I'm getting a lot of complaints about signage that can't be read. So do you know when we'll get that signage up?
So right now we've actually done an on-street assessment and audit of the curbs and the signs, and I know that I'm just going to look over my shoulder to the commander because I know that he's submitted some requests to engineering. Have we any feedback on any of the requests yet? So I can tell you that it's in progress. We're also working on, from the last stakeholder meeting, we're about to do an audit of the alleys as well because we had some very specific feedback on that. But I can tell you that there have been some requests submitted in regards to some signage improvements and changes as well. So I will say it's in process, and we'll look to get you an update on any ETAs.
Okay, and something I don't know that you and I have talked about specifically, but I have talked about it in this long voyage that we've had getting here, and that is we have a lot of signage that says beach parking ahead. I would really like that changed to parking ahead. And that way people don't think, well, I'm not going to the beach, so I'm not going to go down to the beach lot. I think that might take up a lot of people would think, oh, well, that's where I can go to get a parking place if it just says parking ahead. Okay. I noticed that you have in phase three on the regulatory, on the Coastal Commission. Can you give me an update on that?
So we basically haven't gone to Coastal Commission yet because we need to take the municipal code request to you first. And make sure that if we're going to make any changes or request changes to the municipal code, and then from there tackle so that we go to Coastal Commission comprehensively with everything at one fell swoop. So anything that we need to basically go to them. So I would say that post municipal code request to you, so that way if we have anything we have to take to Coastal Commission as a result of that, but also comprehensively as of any other issues that we need to tackle with them.
What about our neighbors that are asking for relief for the 1 hour on their sides when the rest of the town has them? Nothing has been done for them?
Let me just turn over to Vicki and see if I'm nothing at this point.
Okay. I've promised somebody that I would work on that since I was on the Planning Commission.
Okay.
I'm termed out. like to see if we could get that done.
Okay.
Also on the license plate recognition, I think we should start right now by letting people know that that'll include the 72 hours rule, which is a California code. Many, many, many people in our town do not know we have a 72-hour rule because it's never applied to them, and you know it'll apply to them just as soon as these license plate readers start going around. So other than that, I apologize, but I need to leave. Julie, you've done a really great job, and you are a terrific leader of public meetings. So
thank you
very much.
We wouldn't be here without the team, so thank you for that.
All right. Thank you.
Thank you. Anyone else? Yeah. Councilmember Moore?
Hi.
You're excused. Thank you. Okay. You need
to
vote.
I'd just like to reiterate that you did a great job here, and I liked how you had the different vendors as a test, and that we were able to look at each of them, and so I really like the approach. I have a few questions on the meters on the beach. There's only one that accepts dollars. Could you explain why you decided that?
Yes. Well, if it was my preference, there would be none that took dollars. And the one reason why is because it's a tremendous maintenance issue. It costs a lot of money to support those meters because of the jams and the issues of bad currency bills, wet bills, you name it. But one of the, after talking with staff, the recommendation, especially to support the clientele, especially by the pier, was to put at least one what's called a bill note acceptor by the pier and look at the utilization. And we'll monitor it very closely. We do have the option, if it becomes a need for the community, that we can always upgrade the other equipment. But I can tell you from experience that we've worked with very popular tourist destinations where we've eliminated the bill note acceptors, and it has not been an issue at all, especially with utilization of mobile payment and the fact that you can still pay by coin. But the fact is that we wanted to make sure that there was at least one option available, and we chose to have it by the pier location to really try to support those constituents that might want to utilize bills. But it is a significant maintenance issue, and most of the technology providers recommend against putting them in because it's such a challenge.
Will there be some signs on the other ones where to go to the dollar?
We were just speaking about that today, and we're definitely going to work on a revamp of the signage throughout the beach lots, and we'll make sure that it's identified at the meters where you can pay with bills.
Okay.
Just one quick interruption. We'll have to take a vote to excuse.
Well, he has to get his questions answered before he can vote, right?
Well, we have more questions after him, so.
Oh, we do.
Do you want to wait for all of them? Or do you want to be excused now?
Well, how much longer do you think it's?
Oh, just a couple of minutes.
I'm going to have questions, and I think she has.
Okay.
So do you want to be excused now?
I'll just.
Okay.
Okay. Sorry.
Do you want to have a motion?
Oh, you want to vote before?
But that's. Do we have to vote for Councilmember Deaton to be excused? Do we need a vote for that?
Well,
she could just leave.
She doesn't. Okay. She doesn't need to stay for the vote if she needs to leave.
Sorry.
Will there be an ability to see available spots, like, in the future?
So the intention, and this really goes into kind of that signage program, is that to evaluate the technology to be able to provide the information for available parking. Right now, we don't have the infrastructure in the beach lots, but it's something that we've definitely talked about. And in fact, one of the items that's included as an optional service in the Genetech contract is for the LPR contract is actually to incorporate cameras that can also provide the counts for those parking spaces as well. So it's not part of this phase one, but if that's something that the city's interested in pursuing, there's between the Genetech contract as well as some other technology providers that we can basically consider for those locations as well.
And would they interface with an app where you can see, oh, here's the available spots?
Absolutely. They can definitely tie into a lot of the publicly available apps as well, and it's something that we've definitely talked about. It just wasn't as high on the priority list.
Okay. And in your experience with where you've implemented similar meters, has it improved the businesses in that area, or like, what have the results been financially?
Sure. So the real effect comes in, it's actually not really tied to the equipment. It's usually tied to the enforcement. Typically, you see an uptick because of the convenience of the credit card payments, but you have to make sure that you staff the compliance factor as equitably as you put the new technology out there. In my experience, we've always seen an uptick in revenue as a result of the smart meters, the ability to pay with credit cards, and providing all the customer conveniences, but you always have to make sure that you sustain the level of enforcement so that people understand that they can't just, you know, cut corners or not pay. They have to know that there's a penalty if you don't pay for the parking or pay for the experience. So in general, again, we've seen an increase in revenue, but one of the factors, again, I have to emphasize is that this particular project is really about compliance and really about customer service and improving the overall. It wasn't about revenue generation, but sustainable costs, we absolutely anticipate that.
Okay. And what's the lifespan of these meters?
So you're typically estimating about 7 years with proper maintenance. That's been about give or take the lifespan. In some cases, depending on weather conditions and being so close to the beach community, maybe about 5 years too, but it really goes into the preventative maintenance program, and that's one of the reasons why when we talk about the ABM agreement and the City of Long Beach agreement, the proper training of those staff and making sure that we have a very comprehensive preventative maintenance program is really, really key to the longevity of that equipment. The same goes for the LPR equipment. It really goes into kind of the care and feeding of the infrastructure and making sure that we're, you know, taking care of it and it's not subject to, you know, excessive abuse.
Okay, thank you.
Mm-hmm. Thank you.
I think you may have answered some of my questions. It had to do with, you know, also the variety of vendors up there. And if you've got a handheld in citation reader in this lot, is that the same citation reader that can be used on the street and that sort of thing? They also talk about this is their own mobile person or vendor, and you know, but I gather that third party, they accept third party, and just asking, wondering if it's all going to go smoothly together, I guess is my worry. So
it's all going to talk to each other. What's really important is the drivers, in order to participate in Seal Beach, was that the vendors acknowledged and accepted the fact that they're going to have to play nicely together as the key. And it's actually written into our contracts as well. It's called an API. The computer term is how the data transmits to the other systems. And so a great example is Parkeon is your pay station. And so what ends up happening is Parkeon actually has to speak to the LPR vendor, so the actual vehicle devices, and it also has to speak to data ticket because your handheld enforcement devices. But now, I'm just going to show you this, just the permit data that comes out of data ticket that handles the residential parking passes,
okay,
that has to speak to Genetech for the LPR technology as well,
okay,
so that way that all ties in together. And so you would, there's, if I started drawing lines between all of the systems, there would be overlap and lines that touched basically all of the solutions. And the neat thing, too, is that your two support vendors in the bottom right corner, they actually have lines into all of the technology that they touch as well, because they'll be handling the maintenance and they'll get the alerts for the technology as well. And that's the one really big advantage to what we're talking about, all of this technology. It's all smart technology, and the best thing about the smart technology is that single space parking meter, if somebody jams some cotton in it, or there's, you know, whatever happens, it just, you know, the something goes haywire, somebody jams a quarter in there, the meter will actually send an alert to your maintenance staff that says, hey, help me, I'm not working correctly right now. And that's something that really, when you talk about preventative maintenance, and that's why when you ask about the revenue and the increases, you can anticipate that that's really where your value comes, is because the system is telling you when it's not working properly, unlike waiting for a technician to come out and respond to it. So, and that's all part of that tie-in, why in the next phase we're going to look at the support agreements to support all this equipment to make sure that we have the responsive proactive responses that we need to handle and make sure the equipment stays up as well.
And it looked like most of the support for these systems are all Southern California anyway. So
exactly. In fact, that is absolutely the case. One of the real advantages we have, and I have to highlight, because Data Ticket was actually one of your existing vendors, mm-hmm. and I just want to emphasize, and their contract isn't up here tonight because that one was already handled, but we were actually able to leverage your Data Ticket contract and take some existing triggers that were in that contract and actually expand upon those. And that's how we ended up with the advanced permit system that we actually had when we did permit sales back in December. That's a direct result of Data Ticket, who was based in Newport Beach, but I think they just moved their office to Irvine. But very locally based, basically all of the vendors up there have a local presence. So,
okay. Let's see what else. I had another question in a sec. So this would allow, when we have large special events in town, we have VIP special guests come in, you could give them a code for the lot? Is that something that's ahead? Because sometimes it's like, where are we going to have these people park and that kind of thing. So
you're going in the right direction. Okay. So technically, yes. So the system actually can be set up so that when I talked about merchant validation, that's something that you can actually give people a coupon code, things like that, that can actually be used at the meters. We're not setting that up on day one, but you have those bells and whistles to be able to take advantage of as well. The only caveat I have to say about that, if it's a set-aside where the parking is blocked off, that's one thing. The biggest challenge you have is what they call parking reservation systems, where you would never want to do something like that in your beach lots because you don't have gate controls, mm-hmm. and you'd have people probably, you know, going to battle over parking spaces.
Okay.
You know what I mean. But if you have gate controls, which I'm not suggesting, but I just want to highlight that's the one difference about parking reservations. But the coupon codes and things like that, the system will absolutely let you do that.
Okay. I think that's all for now.
Thank you. I have a couple questions. You answered most of them about the interfacing with all the systems. That's really good. Is a large team approach typical in most of these type scenarios and beach cities and stuff like that, where you have all these different companies doing different things?
You know what I have to say, it is, especially now. We had a few years ago where we had the vendors that were providing the turnkey one-stop shop solutions. And in one of those cases, there was a company that went bankrupt about 3-4 years ago, and we're dealing with the aftermaths of those programs right now because we had cities that invested their entire parking operation. Everything that you see on this wall was in one vendor solution, and the city of San Leandro is just coming out from under that. They haven't had a paid parking operation for about 2 years right now, so that's been a real challenge. The key about this, I think, that's strategic is the fact that, again, it's the best in class, but the change in our industry that's happened over these last couple of years is that whole playing nice with others. What they've learned is that with the advancement of smart cities and the direction that communities are going and municipalities are, if they want to survive, they have to basically integrate with each other and they have to communicate with each other. And that's something the walls are kind of coming down over the last few years because of that. With the smart, we have really big players coming into the industry with the smart city solutions. So these vendors all know that if they want to survive it, they need to basically participate in it. So I think that you're seeing this very comparably across the board.
Okay. Just for clarity, we're not talking about meters on Main Street.
No, we are not.
No meters. These are meters in the parking lots.
It's replacement of it's a change for change. So where you have existing infrastructure, it's a swap of the exactly. matching infrastructure. So single space for single space,
I know that.
Base station for base station.
The public knows that.
Yeah.
And then what percent is the bill pay notification? Do you know offhand? Like, is that a big percentage of paying?
With the actual currency bills for the bill note acceptors, it actually varies by community, but I can say that it really depends on, well, what it really depends on is what the rate structure is. And so it does vary by geography, and it varies by what the actual rate structure is. If the rate is, and I'm not saying this is your rate, but if the rate is $20, it's a very easy way for people that have $20 on them to just feed that meter in versus if the rate is $12. So that's why there's a bunch of factors that go into that. But I will tell you that we will monitor it very closely upon installation because, like I said, we have the option to add bill note acceptors if we need to, and we'll definitely pay really close attention to the utilization.
Okay, so Long Beach would still need to be involved, I guess, because there still is a bill pay.
For now, the intention for us is the next phase is to evaluate the services, and our plan is to run a solicitation for parking operations support, and we'll come back to you with any recommendations associated with that.
Okay. So like a sample scenario, in the past, I'm not a techie. I used to get like a little ticket, put my money in, get a ticket. I could see right there was, you know, 12 to 2, for example. I go to the beach, you know, I know it says 2 o'clock. Now, if I put my license plate number in there, I pay the amount, whatever it is, how do I get the notification, or how do I know? I have a smartphone, I have a watch, how do I know? I have to go run, I can't even run back to the meter because it's not a meter. It's just the parking stall. I mean, how do I get that if I'm not a tech-savvy person or I don't have a phone or...
Sure. So if you're going to, you'll enter your license plate, and there can be the option to print a receipt so that you'll have all of that information on the receipt. And the receipt can be optional or it can be required, however the city wants to set it up. A lot of cities are going green, so they like to give the option to customers. But I can say very clearly on the display screen, which in the option that we presented is a color screen, so that it should be very vibrant and very clear to the user. It will very clearly state on the screen when you've entered in your plate and made your payment, it will very clearly tell you your session expires at whatever time it is. So it is very clear on the screen, and you will have the option to print a receipt if that's something that the city wants to do.
Okay. Well, I know that's an issue with people. And then the sunlight glare issue is always a big issue with the direction that the meter, the big box meters are facing. So I know you'll look at that.
We'll look at that during the installation for sure.
Yeah, I was able to attend the stakeholders engagements, and I thought it was very well handled. And I know you have a great team with, you know, Commander Bowles and the city staff. So
for sure.
Thank you for all of that. I have no further questions. Do you have another one?
Yeah, I have. And I wanted to thank you also for the meeting, and I appreciate the parking tour. That was very, very helpful to see what it was, and feel confident that we've looked at all and given it all a fair chance. I just wanted to ask about, it was talking in the staff report about paying for your citations or paying for your fines. I wanted to know if this is going to be possible, and also is that going to help us out over our present situation?
So you'll have the option. So this is where we start to talk about how things talk to each other. We can set it up so that on the mobile payment, you could actually pay your parking citation. So that's another convenience. But then with data ticket, you can basically pay your tickets online as well. So there's a lot of customer conveniences that come along with that too. So I think that what you're going to see with this array of vendors is that as many times as we can make it as easy as possible for the customer to utilize the system, whether it be to make a payment, whether it be to verify their time, whatever the service is, that's what a lot of the amenities that come along with these vendor features are. It's very customer-centric, very customer, you know, friendly, so that, again, it's all about, we talk about the parking experience. We want it to be a positive one, and that's why what the council member said about the signage, that's a big part of our next phase, is that we know that we have to tackle the signage as well so that we can help people find parking even easier as well. So.
Okay, but this will be fairly instant so that you don't have to wait days or something.
This is when we talk about real time. Mm-hmm. That's one of the definitions for us of real time is that, not that we all want to get parking tickets, but if I get a parking ticket, I could literally pay it upon receipt because the ticket is in the system. There's no lag time between my receipt of a parking ticket and my ability to pay it. So that should help with collections as well.
One more question. Some of these systems, I'm not sure if it was what we have or if it was an added service, but said you could get possibly a text that you're going to expire in 5 minutes or whatever it is. Is that available too?
Yes. So your passport mobile payment it's all programmable so that when I, let's just say I thought I was just going to run in for an hour and I only bought an hour worth of time, it will send you an alert that says you have the ability to extend your time. You can buy an additional hour and it'll give you the option. Just like what I say if I was sitting on the beach, I can do that too because I was like, oh, it's time to basically end as well.
Okay. Thank you very much.
No problem.
All right. Thank you.
Thank you.
Do we have a motion for resolution 1, 2, 3, and 4?
Is it all? Do we have to do these separately or?
No, you can take one motion on all.
One motion and done.
Okay. What's your pleasure?
Okay.
Motion to approve item A.
Do we have a second?
Second.
Please vote. Motion carries 3-0. Okay, thank you.
Okay.
Okay, I guess there's no new business. And
we have to do each one separate. That was the first one.
No, that was for all of item E.
That was for all of them. Okay. Yeah.
Okay. Next item is new business. There's no new business items. We will adjourn the City Council meeting to Monday, February 26, 2018 at 5:30 p.m. to meet in closed session if deemed necessary. We now have to convene for special successor agency matters. We'll call this meeting to order. And then council roll call.
Chair Verapapa?
Here.
Member Moore?
Here.
Member Sestarsic?
Here.
Members Deaton and Masalavit are absent.
Okay, we'll open it up to oral communications. Do I need to read all that again?
You don't have to read it. You don't have to read it all again.
Do we have any oral comments at this time? Seeing none, we'll move to the consent calendar. Items on the consent calendar are considered to be routine and are enacted by a single motion with the exception of items removed by council members. Would anyone like to remove any items?
No.
Seeing none?
Chair Verapapa, if I could jump in for just a moment before you take action. So there was a couple of residents that came up tonight and talked about the checks that were listed in the successor agency. After we put the packet together, what we realized is since the last meeting, the city has switched from Bank of America to Bank of the West. We have two separate bank accounts, one for the city general account and one for the successor agency. And we discovered that we don't have the ability at this point, although we're talking to our software vendor, to separate when we run this report for the check register by bank account. So there's duplicate checks that are listed because the check numbers for each bank account started with the same number. They both started at 1001. So there are some duplicate checks in here. I can assure you, however, that the report on the for each of the fiscal years that show the checks that were run and the totals, that those are the accurate totals. And I could go through if you wanted me to and show you or tell you which checks are duplicate, but I just wanted you to be aware that's why those duplicate checks showed up. They were not money that were spent for city items with successor agency money.
Thank you. I'm fine with that. Okay, would you like to make a motion?
Okay. I'd like to make a motion to approve the consent calendar.
The second?
Second.
Please vote. Vote is 3-0. Thank you. And we'll adjourn the successor agency to a date uncertain. Thank you.
Thank you all. Yeah.